You are now entering the world of Musings of a Geek podcast network. Stay geeky, my friends.
Congratulations. Hi, my name is Mark, and your side quest is over. That's right, your mission has been completed. You found this podcast. Whether you rolled that D20 or you did that whole up, up, down, down, left, right, black, start, whatever combination Konami code that was. I can't remember. I'm old. Leave me alone. Anyway, you're probably listening to this on a mobile device. iOS, Android, Windows. But did you also know that you can find this show along with so many others like it? Although admittedly, there are no shows quite like this one. Believe me, I know. I've looked. But you can always find the latest episode of this show at Tangibound Network. Go to tangiboundnetwork.com, look it up, check it out, listen from the site. It's even mobile friendly. How awesome is that? Go check it out, tangiboundnetwork.com.
Growing up with Broke Suki, Superman before Zack Snyder ruined him.
Man,
Michael Keaton was the best Batman, while Christian Bale was just deadpan. No one remembers the other ones. Princess Leia in bikinis,
oh, yeah,
and Transformer Lamborghinis.
Yeah.
Please don't let Shia LaBeouf ever act again.
Please, God, no.
Remembering tales from the crypt,
I
back
do.
When Michael Bay wrote good scripts.
He wrote good
all
scripts.
All right, here is old mystery. It's the history of bad.
It's bad.
It's the history of bad.
So bad.
It's the history of bad ideas. It's the history of bad.
It's bad.
It's the history of bad.
So bad.
It's the history of bad ideas.
Podcast.
Whoa! Welcome to the History of Bad Ideas, episode number 86. I'm Jason.
I'm Jeff.
Hello.
And on the horse-drawn carriage today...
Hello!
...is musician to HOBI, Chris Bednar. Welcome, Chris.
Thank you. Glad
Yay,
to be back.
Hey, Chris.
Chris is here. It's been a couple weeks, a couple months.
Weeks? It's been months, man.
Well, that's just multiple weeks.
Multiple weeks.
That's because you're not allowed on the show.
You're only allowed to write music for the show.
Apparently, that's how I get myself on the show. So that's understandable. That's fine.
And the intro is because this is a geek podcast, but it's also a Monty Python-centric one a little bit later on here.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. What do you have drinking, Chris?
Yay. I am drinking a Monty Python's Holy Grail Ale, tempered over burning witches.
Ooh.
Yes. And there was much rejoicing.
Did you buy this just for the show, or do you have this at your house?
I bought it just for the show.
Nice.
Because I knew we were doing the 40-year Monty Python. I'm a huge Monty Python fan, so I wanted to bring it in honor of our show here tonight. So
okay.
I've got one for everyone, so I hope everyone gets to enjoy at least one.
Got
Holy
one.
Grail Ale.
I'm drinking an Ichabod from New Holland. So I will be drinking that next.
Okay.
I have enough calories in my diet to do it.
Oh, you do?
Yes.
All right. Unlike this weekend.
Shut it.
Are you counting?
We go play poker this weekend, and Jason has to count his calories. He was allowed 2 beers.
I'm down 15 pounds, bitches.
All right.
And how many peanuts?
Penises?
Peanuts.
Oh, peanuts. Well, 1,000.
Well, everybody knows that's your protein dose, but come on. I'm talking about carbs.
Sorry.
Ew.
Anyways, welcome, Chris.
Yeah, hey, welcome. Yeah.
You guys haven't missed a beat.
And let's see here. We're on nerdly.co.uk.
As we are every week.
Yes. Every Wednesday.
Cheerio.
That's right.
Oh, hello.
And thank
you. Nerdly.co.uk. You're a loony.
So I hope they appreciate the Monty Python.
sorry, that'll be coming to you all day, all night here.
And also, thank you for everybody listening, even the new listeners. We've had a big influx in listenership, so I appreciate that.
Thank you for listening to your 1.5 podcast.
1.5.
They only get through halfway through the second before they say, screw this.
Well, we're 2 hours long, and they're like, fuck this.
My commute's only 45 minutes.
Hey, we're down to an hour and 45 minutes around that the last 2 weeks. So, and Doug, number one fan, is not here this week.
so he won't bog us down with all his Disney talk.
Oh, my God. So, and then anything else? You guys got anything?
What else are we on?
We are on Tangent Bound Network.
Awesome.
Musings of a Geek Network, our original ones. We're on Wicket Radio Network.
Wicket.
You can Google any of these.
That's not a S&M site.
No. Could be, though. Could be. Yeah. Devin's kind of creepy. You know,
what about Danger Entertainment? Is that an S&M site?
Danger.
We're on Danger with Michael Leal.
You gotta say that.
I don't know.
You have to say that correctly. We're on Danger Entertainment.
Hey! And then...
But he can't do that impersonation.
No.
Yeah, that's right.
I can do Michael Caine. Really good Michael Caine.
Really?
Yes.
I don't think anybody's heard your Michael Caine impersonation.
Wait, no, for them, I'm not going to do it. And then finally, we're on Geek Life Radio every Friday, 10 a.m. Eastern, 9 a.m. Central. So check us out, along with tons of reviews, along with nerdly.co.uk also has reviews along with Geek Life Radio.
Yeah, that's like at the plus 5 or plus 6 hours. If you're not... in the East or Central Coast U.S., you're going to have to go to Google and figure that out.
Google time zone they call it.
And also, two other things, and then we'll get to the show here. We have a $25 iTunes gift card, courtesy of Doug, number one fan.
That's 25 U.S. American dollars.
Yes,
it is.
So if you give us a review on iTunes and let us know it, you're going to be entered in a drawing. And that will raffle it off. And
yes, if you're in the UK, that means you have to write a review and an extra quarter, 25% of review, because your reviews are worth more than one U.S. American dollar.
We have at least one review in the UK. Kevin James Lover actually did a review for us.
Kevin James Lover!
So, and then finally, go to Podcast Land and please vote for us. We're tied for first place for Podcast of the Month, so please do that.
Yes, we need to move our votes up from 8 to 9.
No, we're in the teens.
We have struck the teens.
Oh, yeah, middle teens. So,
we got as many votes that Jared Fogle is no longer looking our way.
Oh, wow. Is that too soon? Is that too soon?
Where's Nick?
Thanks, Nick. A little bit slow on the snare drum. So let's get to the show.
There'll be a lot of that going on.
Do you have any stories this week, Blake?
Oh, story time with Blake.
Do we have story time?
Story time. Story time. Story time with Blake. This story may not make any sense, but it'll tell it to us anyway. So sit back. Story time with Blake.
I don't have a story.
What?
You're killing me.
2 weeks
You're
in a row
me.
You don't have a story. Did you walk into a women's locker room?
No.
Almost walk into a woman's locker room? Did you get attacked by sharks?
No.
Did you have a funeral pride?
No.
Remember when you were in Afghanistan?
No. This is supposed to be.
Oh, Blake, how about that one time when you did that one thing at that one place?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, that was really funny.
Yeah. Hanno, I know you like story time with Blake. We apologize for.
Good story, Blake.
God.
I can tell a story of when Jason tried to break my hand. It still hurts.
Does it?
Yes.
So story time with Jeff?
Oh, story time with Jeff.
Story time with Jeff.
Well, we were playing poker this weekend, and Jason started messing with my stack of money, so I started messing with his stack of money, and he jams his elbow right down in the center of my hand, and I let out a gut-benching yell because...
It wasn't even a yell. It was a yelp.
Yeah, more of a yelp.
Okay, how about it?
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
So I think I broke his hand. I think I did.
Were you on the disabled list for the rest of the night for poker?
No, I was able to play one-handed.
His social life was hampered, though, for the rest of the night.
Or it could have been enhanced.
It could be
a strange encounter that evening.
Well, as I told him, it was my masturbating hand. I think Chris is getting ready to leave now.
Chris, can you take me with you?
It's a wanker.
I fart in your general direction. Your mother was a hamster and your father smelt of elderberry.
That was rude.
Okay, so listener feedback.
Listener feedback from Doug.
Number one fan.
Can't give yourself a nickname.
Yeah. Who's Doug again?
I don't know. He's only been here 5 weeks out of six.
Is that why we had Pez left over tonight?
Do we have Pez left over?
Well, not anymore.
Yeah, not anymore.
I have some more. I'll get some at the break. I promise.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That was the guy that ate all our Pez.
Huh?
That's right. Doug says, what did you guys think of the Deadpool trailer?
The red band was great. The green band was, left a lot to be desired.
Yes, the red band was awesome. Bednar, did you see the red band trailer of Deadpool?
I did.
And
I'm not excited.
What?
I'm not. You know what I think the issue is I think I'm just worn out with it a little bit. I think I'm just a little worn out. I just need to take a break from it all.
Okay.
Give it a year. Comic book movies?
Yeah, I think that's what I'm getting at. It's not, because I was actually mentioning this to Blake earlier, that I tried to watch Daredevil and Arrow and some of these other shows too, and I'm just I'm done. I've actually gotten into Gotham a little bit recently. Oh. But I'm just not following. It's just starting to lose its...
Is it because you saw Fantastic Four and that was the pinnacle of comic book movies and nothing can top that?
No, the original Fantastic Four, there's nothing that can top
it. I did hear a rumor that you saw the Roger Corman version.
Yes, I did.
I thought it was Fantastic Four, Back to the Future.
Ooh. That would have been better. I would have taken Michael J. Fox even now.
Days of Future Past.
Oh, that was your favorite movie.
Back to Fantastic Four.
Ooh, that would be a good mashup. Somebody do that. Combine those two.
Blake is just over there spurting out sentence fragments, lighting things on fire.
I just want to say, I mean, obviously this is all going towards, there's going to be eventually a DC versus Marvel universe, and it's going to just be this massive, I'm just going to wait until that comes. I'm just done.
Dogs and cats living together. Total anarchy.
So let me ask you this. You saw the Roger Corman Fantastic Four. I've seen that. Jeff has seen that.
Ooh.
Blake, I don't think has yet.
No,
so we have our own special little club here now.
I don't know if it's special.
We're special. That's for damn sure.
Do we get special rings or anything?
No. But the sad thing is, Doctor Doom in the Roger Corman Fantastic Four was a lot better than in any other Fantastic Four movie.
I actually might agree with that.
He's actually a bad guy.
He's actually Doctor Doom.
Yes,
a bad guy. So that's already a bonus for him.
He looks better than in the other ones. Two.
Yeah.
You're talking about all the LED LCD lights on his face?
Oh, God. The new one was great with him. So
I haven't even watched it. I only watched the previous one because Jessica Alba was in it. So,
she was very, very good at Sue Storm.
No, she wasn't.
Yeah.
Did you read Fantastic Four growing up?
No, not really. I knew of it. Like Spider-Man was the only one that I ever got really into and actually read, but... I knew of Fantastic Four. I was always intrigued by it, but never read it. So I knew Doctor Doom, but my first true exposure to this was the second Fantastic Four movie.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well.
So the one you let me borrow, that one actually was
better.
A breath of fresh air. Because I knew what it was going in. It was like, I'm going to see I'm going to watch a B movie. Okay, C, D, E, F, G, J. Like a...
Z
movie-ish. Z-A. So it was bad. But it was better than the second one, which is speaking a lot, considering that it was made on what, about...
A hundredth
of the budget? Yeah.
Let me ask you this. So Deadpool... Do you know anything about Deadpool besides X-Men Origins?
Just a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah, the X-Men Origins.
Okay.
Yeah.
He's a lot better than that.
Yes. From what I've read, I understand that too.
You know what? I think we should make Chris sing all of his answers.
Ooh.
What? What are you talking about?
You stupid bird
brain! Well... being the second lead singer on this group of HOBI, I could join you for a melody.
Sure.
Okay. Blake, do you have the next question?
After being on 5 of 6 weeks, that's number one fan Doug, the only listener feedback that means anything is, do you miss me?
No. It hasn't been enough time to miss you yet.
Oh, wow. Not enough Disney talk, though. I'm missing that.
It needs to be at least, three, 4 days. Years before I'll start missing them.
Wow. What happens if I left?
Oh, I'd miss you immediately.
Really?
Yeah.
I doubt that. Is that just because it's mostly my equipment?
Well, yeah, I mean...
Oh, no, we can shoot in my basement now. We've proven that. So I don't know. Maybe we don't miss Jason at all.
All he needs is a cassette tape recorder.
Ooh,
I like it. That's
right. Sony Walkman
with the microphone.
You could just make copies and send them out to our fans.
It was $60 more for the Walkman that you could hit record with, you know?
Well, that's a lot more extra. Yeah.
And back then, that was $500 more.
Does anybody remember the Atari games were $50 back
then?
Yeah.
That's unbelievable. Yeah. That's insane.
That was
isn't that unbelievable? They're $50 now.
Yeah, but back then, $50 was a lot more than $50 now.
But it also costs more to make, to print those discs.
I'm not doubting that, but that's a lot of money.
It's all called about inflation.
Yeah, I don't know.
Anyways, higher prices caused by less money in the market.
Of course, we had a Commodore 64C, so that helped.
It's true.
I had a VIC-20.
Really? Let's see.
Did you like it?
Yeah, I made something that looked like a bird flap its wings.
After typing in code for an hour?
Yeah.
Now I make a turtle go in a square. That was on the TI-99.
I don't know what that one is.
Exactly.
That was before my time.
So anyways, Doug, yeah, I kind of miss Doug.
Okay. That was it.
Well, how can we miss Doug when we got Chris in the studio?
We do.
That's true.
Doug didn't write music for you guys.
That's right. Chris wrote the theme song.
I sat down in my studio.
Theme
song? Had to go through several beers before I could get motivated enough to write story time with Blake.
I hear that a lot. People
actually
have to go through plenty of beers before they can get motivated.
If I may, actually, I wrote story time with Blake while driving in the car back from one of my clients at work because I was listening to the HOBI podcast.
At least one of our guests does.
I think it was episode 82 or 83, and Blake goes into a story, and I hear Jason or Jeff, maybe both of you, kind of in the background going, and at this point, Jeff had already mentioned to me at one of our softball games, hey, you should write a story time with Blake song. And I told him, this was 2 months ago, sure, I'll do that. Right, you know, because it's really high on that list of shit that I need.
Oh, the priority list. I don't understand how Hobie isn't number one.
So then when
I don't get it either.
When I heard it on the way back, I go, oh my God, Jason's fucking singing.
Hey!
So then I decided, right,
somebody's got to do something
so
about this.
So I paused the podcast and I thought, what would be good here? And it had been a good day, so I'm kind of thinking... Story time. That was it.
And
the rest from there. And the rest is Hobie history.
Yes, that, ladies and gentlemen, is called genius.
And Blake will never have another story to tell for the rest of the Hobie podcast career.
That's pretty impressive. Good, Blake. Continue.
Oh, Randall Holt at RJ Holt 666. He's not evil. He's just handled that way. He said, kite-eating tree for the win. Totally took me by surprise.
Jason. Me.
You take second. Jason. Number one fan, Doug, is third.
And Jeff is last by DQ.
Yes. And Jess is last by DQ, yes.
That was for the
draft
last week when we redrafted the South Park characters.
Yes, right. My kite-eating tree gets the win. For the win.
That was a stroke
for
of
the
genius.
Win, Jack. I'll take kite-eating tree.
That was a stroke
center
of genius.
Center square. Yes.
Once Kite Eating Tree came out, I just knew my list was
crap. Your list was crap to begin with.
Hey, he told me because of my pick for Kyle, I probably was up for the win until I DQ'd myself.
Well, Nickel said he was really enjoying being a part and feeling honored to be part of the draft. And then Jason had to go be an asshole about it and start mocking him. And so he felt a little hurt by it. So I apologize, but you were the best pick, Nickel, and that was not a good sign. For Jeff.
Forgot.
All right.
Nope.
So, from the Pop Culture Cafe at TPCCFA says, a horrible F word, all capital letters. Close your ears if you're under the age of 16.
Fook!
I see a Torch Boy movie. Okay, no, I won't. Hey, I don't like the Torch Boy movie. Yeah, okay.
Well, let me tell you this.
I see a Torch Boy movie, and then I see Dr. Doom with LCD lights all over his face.
What's wrong with the Torch Boy movie?
Ah, Torch Boy movie.
Can we make
you
it?
You got a problem with the Torch Boy movie?
The Torch Boy movie is a great idea.
We're grading like that to the top.
Draw all the way up, And get that big rock guy with the rocky butt.
Rocky and Bullwinkle?
I like them.
Can we do a crossover?
That thing.
Oh, the thing. The thing.
Yeah, that thing. And Torch Boy.
Just make sure that thing wears no pants.
Yeah, we like rock crack.
And bring back Jessica Alba. In a bikini.
Whoa, bikini.
Okay. Whoa.
Ah, that's okay. There you go.
Just
book it.
Was that your 20th Century Fox?
Here's 10 million.
10 million?
20.
20?
For Alba?
Jessica.
Jessica Alba in a bikini. That's at least 30 million.
Yeah, Torch Boy goes for half that much. Not that. And the thing, all computer generated. Ah, CG. Ah, bring in Spielberg. Yeah, what's his name? Lucas. Yeah.
Locus? You want to bring Locus in? Could they be the bad guys?
Yeah, create that Jar Jar guy. Yeah. Great idea.
Could we get Jar Jar for it?
Yeah.
How much is Jar Jar going
for these days? $500
Six?
Six.
Inflation.
Deflation. Anyways.
He is life size.
Yeah.
Torchboy got some comments on Twitter, so.
Torchboy, yeah. Yeah, bring in Torchboy.
Fucking give me that Torchboy. Good job, Blake. That's Human Torch.
All right, from Bob. In 5 years, they should reboot X-Men with Hugh Jackman as Professor X. Just because it would be funny. Yeah, you think male pattern baldness is funny, huh? You think Hugh Jackman's gonna go bald in a couple years?
I am going bald, and I do think it's funny.
Oh, okay.
I think it's funny that the hairy mutant will then become the bald mutant.
The hairy Wolverine guy becomes the bald guy.
Yeah.
I see the irony.
It's funny because it's true. Yeah.
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 All right, I'll get Torch Boy playing because, Torch Boy, when he lights up, he burns all his hair off. Yeah, there you go. Write it in there.
You know, the sad thing is I was just going to say the same exact thing. Burn his hair off.
Burn his hair off. And his clothes.
Okay, moving on.
Get some Hulk purple pants. From Elhano at Idahano, grooving on the new...
Time with Blake.
Okay, Chris, thank you. Thanks for the draft day intro reminder on my studio docket. It just says HOBI intro, and that was a bit vague. For a minute, I thought I meant Vogue. I was like, yes,
strike
right.
Strike a pose, Vogue, strike a pose. See, look at my singing.
That's right.
That's the singing?
What, it's going to be a holiday HOBI CD?
Yeah, keep going.
It's going to be a holiday HOBI CD. Please read
all your,
"Twas the Night Before Christmas" in sections with various HOBI impressions.
We need to talk about this first, because my contract specifically states no holiday CDs unless it's Baltic Pride Week.
Okay, how about this?
Is that the same week as Christmas?
Or Arbor Day?
Unfortunately. So we'll sell this Baltic Pride.
I could swung and missed on that one, didn't I?
Well, hey, did you see he wants to read "Twas the Night Before Christmas" with various HOBI impressions?
"Twas the Night Before Christmas" and all through the house. Not I don't know who I was doing there.
are we doing HOBI impressions or impressions of HOBI impressions?
I don't think it matters, does it?
No, I don't know because HOBI. I mean,
the fire was burning because some people just want to watch it burn.
Oh, there it was.
Was that you doing your gambit saying your...
Michael Caine?
Michael Caine?
It was now. It is now. And somehow, before
I think
I get
you could
this,
pull it off.
Yeah. I think I can do it. I might do it.
No, I mean, the three of you, you know, you guys are...
We can do the Twas Night Before Christmas.
We'll do a special HOBI Christmas.
Well, we do it. So, we do a...
Special HOBI Christmas. That's inclusive.
I'll bring my guitar in. I'll throw something in the background for you guys while you guys take care of it.
Okay.
You know? Special HOBI Christmas that's inclusive to atheists, Muslims, and Jews. And Wiccans.
Hey, I got a Wiccan book over there.
There you
in
go.
The Baltics.
In the Baltics.
In the Baltics. We're definitely celebrating.
That's right.
And the Druids. They haven't had a mass in 2,000 years, but I think they're due. I think they're due.
They are.
Mm-hmm.
And also, I do want to say, while we're talking quick about impressions, 365 Flicks Podcast can go screw themselves. They're saying that I'm a...
What?
They said I'm a pure diva.
Well, you are.
No!
Yeah.
Devo.
Whip it.
We know you're a wanker.
They called me a diva. So I'm a little hurt.
It might mean something different over in...
No, he said, Jason's a total, a pure diva, and I like it. I love it. He just fucking hates everything, and I love it.
Is that your Scottish accent? Now?
I don't know what that was.
No, this is Welsh accent.
Welcome to the rock.
No, that's just Irish.
That should never be repeated.
God, good speed, Godspeed, good speed. You know what that means? Shut up, Bill Connery.
Jesus.
That's Sean Connery doing his Irish accent.
Pusher, pushy galore.
Pushy galore.
Pushy galore.
Moving on.
All right. Anyways, Michael Leo. From Michael Lael, listening to Ed Bad Ideas podcast number 79, dude, all in capital letters, exclamation point, finding porn in the woods was totally a thing. Found some myself at Hobi Pod at Amy K. Whalen.
Yes.
We had the discussion about the treasure trove it was being 12 years old and finding porn in the woods back before the internet. And kids today just don't understand how we suffered.
We did. We did suffer on that. Bednar, did you find porn in the woods?
Never really went looking for it.
Well, you don't go looking for it.
You don't
just
go looking for it. You find it. It's like a treasure trove.
I did a lot of hiking in the woods. Never found any porn. Where we normally found the porn was in the drop ceiling or
really?
Somewhere in the house where it shouldn't have been. Kid hid it somewhere.
Garage.
By
the garage.
New house. You look in the ceiling as you're trying to clear it out or work on a house, open up a wall, that's where you find the porn.
Nickel found
that's when the whores come in.
Nickel? Or the dead whores. That's when you find the dead whores in the wall.
You have quite a different childhood than I did. I never found dead whores in the hall. In the
of
hall.
Course you don't put them in the wall, they're underneath the bed. Have you seen Four Rooms?
Yes.
Yes.
There's a dead whore in my bed.
I didn't.
Oh,
Blake's talked about it.
Four rooms.
Come on.
I saw it a long time ago. I don't remember anything about it other than with Tim Roth running around.
Don't misbehave.
We do have two other questions from Michael Lear. We're going to wait till the news of the
questions.
Geek.
News of the Geek.
He just put them in. We got a couple questions.
Couple questions, Michael Lear. That's called a teaser. That means you have to wait.
A couple more minutes.
Or fast forward to the break.
Okay,
No fast forwarding.
This is the best part of the show right
now. That's right.
If somebody just put us on speed 1.5 or 2 right now, they were really fucked. Because if you go, don't
fast forward. Do that 1.5?
No. From Dr. Number 1 at Dr. Number 1, gets it to the monks of oxygen, 1,000 of the hopefuls. Learn how those will make the cut.
I'm sorry, what was that?
That was from Dr. Number 1. And Dr. Number 1, if you go back and play, is at 0.5 speed.
It'll go incredibly fast.
Yeah, said casting took months in auditions and thousands of hopefuls.
For Star Wars.
For Star Wars. Learn about those who didn't make the cut. Go to http://strw.rs/1N 19PK f.
That second one is a capital I, Blake.
Don't worry about it. Anyways, just look it up.
Just Google the fucker.
He was just getting like...
Who the hell puts web addresses in our
URLs
in our
anymore?
Fucking listener feedback.
He was linking. He was linking on Twitter, just so we have
Go to our podcast or Twitter page and put it in there. Don't make me read this shit.
You know, it doesn't have auto-links? Paper.
Yeah,
you print it out on paper, you can't...
Wouldn't it be awesome if you could?
It would be.
No, you just tap on the paper. I find myself doing it. I like tapping on the paper. Fuck, it won't go to the URL.
Sorry to everyone at home who heard all that loud tapping through the microphone.
My bad. Sorry about that. He's got one.
You should do a show on Star Wars episodes 4, 5, and 6, says Dr. Number 1.
Yes, not only do we have a Monty Python episode today, we're going to do a Star Wars themed one around the Christmas time. What do you guys think?
Before the next Star Wars comes out?
Mm-hmm.
Or for Christmas purposes?
No, around when 7 comes out.
Okay.
When 7 comes out, that's a good idea. You guys should.
We are.
Definitely should, yep.
And then we can do like sound effects like meow, meow, meow.
Zoom.
Okay, moving on.
Kiss your sister.
There's your listener feedback, Blake. Good job. Your sister.
It's time for a Monty Python and the Holy Grail episode of the News of the Geek.
Dun dun dun. Okay, Monty Python, we're themed because it's 40th anniversary.
On your lip, your red pants.
Yes, so Monty Python and the Holy Grail came out 40 years ago, which Holy makes me feel shit. Really old.
It was older than you, so
that is true. I appreciate. I do like that.
So it makes you feel.
makes me feel old that it was out before I was born.
Well, I turned 40 this year, and I believe the movie was released in May, so I was officially 30 days old when the movie was released.
Did that make you feel old?
Yes, okay. But I'm honored that the year I was born was the same year that this classic cult movie was made.
One of the greatest movies in cinematic history.
Agreed. Fantastic Four?
But not at the time of the release, though, was it?
Oh, they might not have. Oh, well, no, it made like money. Some of this it made enough money that they made a second movie and then a third movie and et cetera and so forth.
I will look that up for you guys. How much it made in opening.
That should be in our box office news.
It should be. let's see.
Probably beat half the...
Fantastic.
Well, if Pink Floyd didn't make The Dark Side of the Moon, there would be no funding for the Holy Grail.
Why?
This is true.
Well, there would be some funding. They only funded about 10% of it.
No, Pink Floyd took the money from Dark Side of the Moon and funded the movie because they're fans of
not all of the money from Dark Side because it's still considered one of the top 20 albums of all time and still sells like crazy. And I would assume that the group's not getting money from that because I
they're not
you,
still putting in
they
the
would
money
make more
into
money off Dark Side.
They're still
they
funding. They're still
the
funding
Grail.
The Grail to this day. That's why Dark Side of the Moon has been on the number one list for 30 years, 40 years.
Okay, so news of the geek, real quick. Celebration of the 40th anniversary of Monty Python and the Holy Grail. Sony Pictures Home Entertainment has announced it's bringing the classic comedy to Blu-ray.
I'm surprised it wasn't on Blu-ray yet.
I know, I was kind of surprised by that too. I think both a standard version of the Blu-ray and a limited edition gift set will be available October 27th. Both versions will include brand new artwork from Terry Gilliam, as well as 30 minutes of Q&A footage from the Monty Python and Holy Grail event this year's Tribeca Film Festival.
Now, do they have Graham Chapman in a
urn?
In an urn?
That would be
like
funny.
They normally do.
They
which
should.
Is, which is when they do a lot of the anniversaries, they honor Graham with an urn supposedly filled with his ashes and usually with a funny picture or a portrait.
Probably with a dead parrot, too.
And a dead parrot, yes.
Those who opt out for the limited edition... Those who opt out. Those who opt for the limited edition gift set will also receive a collectible castle packaging that features a real catapult action and rubber farm animals.
That'd be awesome.
Hell,
I want that.
Yeah.
In addition, this collector...
English pig dog.
This version also includes exclusive intro letters from both Terry Gilliam and Terry Jones.
The film's directors.
Yes.
The two Terrys. A Tale of Two Terrys.
I just want to get the catapults from my office.
That would be a lot of fun. Yeah,
why are you walking by me?
I have a feeling you won't get the animals back.
No, I probably wouldn't. Sony and Circus Entertainment also announced on August 4th that Monty Python and the Holy Grail will be returning to theaters on October 14th in the UK. Damn you, Nerdly! I can't be mad. That's pretty cool. Where 500 screens will show a sing-along version of the film. The screenings are a one-night-only event and will come along with an introduction from John Cleese, Terry Gilliam, Eric Idle, Terry Jones, and Michael Palin.
And Graham Chapman's urn.
Yes, specifically filmed for the occasion. And there's also plans to bring the film back to theaters internationally and to the United States this fall.
Yeah.
We're all going to that, right?
If it comes out, we're going.
Yeah,
okay.
Absolutely.
And there is much rejoicing.
Pusillanimous behavior makes me vomit.
Okay, I did find out the 2001...
The Space Odyssey?
No. Oh. The reissue of Monty Python and the Holy Grail from 2001, I guess it came out, it made $1.8 million. But there's no numbers on it from the original.
From box office from...
1975. So, yeah, check.
It was probably spread so thin and in so many... Like
that's what I'm...
Art theaters and things like that when it came out because it was such a... It was their very first movie.
And they didn't really keep great records back then.
Right. And even then, they weren't like the mega pop, you know, cult favorite.
This is what made them the mega pop
at the
cult
time.
Comedy
troupe. Right. It was growing over time to
Okay, so let me ask you this. I have seen Monty Python Flying Circus at my grandparents' house and all that stuff. It's been a long time since I've seen a lot of their skits. I've seen some skits here and there on YouTube and all that stuff. But let me ask you this. So when Holy Grail came out, was Flying Circus known?
Oh, yeah.
In the UK, it was a very well-known
entity.
Yes.
And Holy Grail came out. And I think it was known among... It was kind of cult classic in the US at the time, but it was known for people who...
They had played at the Hollywood Bowl.
Yeah, they sold out the Hollywood Bowl.
Actually, the Holy Grail was released in the US before the UK for several weeks, yes.
Okay.
Yeah. And then, of course, the old 70s cast of Saturday Night Live... were big fans of Monty Python. They would actually bring on John Cleese and Eric Idle, would make appearances, and they would actually reenact some of their skits that they used to do on the Flying Circus, of course, being one of the most famous, being the Dead Parrot.
Dead Parrot!
Hello!
I don't know, for my money, the cheese shop is the one that takes it for me.
The cheese shop, which one was that?
When the guy went into the cheese shop looking for cheddar?
Any form of cheese. No, he was looking for specific, cheeses.
Right. He's looking for cheese, and they were always out of everything he asked.
Fresh out.
Fresh out.
We had some yesterday.
Yeah, that's but, right. When he asked for cheddar, he's like, we don't get much call for that in these parts.
It's not only the most popular cheese in the planet.
Well, fun fact, guess how much it costs to make?
$200,000.
Bednar?
Less. I'd say 85,000.
But I say $750,000.
400,000.
Wow.
Oh. Now, here's the thing. Since 2001, it has made roughly 3.4 million. Internationally, 1.6 since 2001, so about 5 million. But I'm still trying to get anything on.
That's since 2001?
That's since 2001. Correct.
And it was released in 75.
Correct.
So you can assume from 75 to about 85, the first 10 years, they finally made their money back, probably.
Probably. I'm sure they made their money back in the first release.
And this brings up a question. When was the first, what I wanted to ask you, when was the first time do you remember seeing Monty Python, the Holy Grail? And who influenced you to watch it?
I don't remember the first time I saw it, but I do remember I was in high school at a... all-boys Catholic school, and I was taking a class about mythology, and we were studying the Arthurian legend at the time. So the teacher goes ahead, and we watched the movies, did his little lecture and said, we'll watch, this movie.
Oh, really?
So we started watching it, and then it got to the Castle Anthrax scene. He stops the movie, and he's like, well, I can't really show this scene, and class is up. So we'll finish the movie tomorrow. So we come back tomorrow and we start after the Castle Anthrax scene is where it picks up. But I know I had seen the movie before then, but I don't remember the first time I saw it because that's the first time I remember seeing it. But I knew of that scene before I saw that. So
my I think I was like six or seven, and
I like that.
My brothers rented it, and I remember it was on VHS, two VHS tapes. Oh. And they stopped at the second tape didn't started right after the holy hand grenade. So that's why. The chanting for it.
Well, that just surprises me.
I remember
because
that.
It's not even a 90-minute movie?
It's 94 minutes.
94 minutes? And
I'm wondering if there was a lot of... I don't know.
I figured they would have stopped it at the intermission.
So...
Intermission music.
Intermission.
The only thing I can think of is Michael Palin naked in front of an organ playing that and looking back over his shoulder with a cheesy mustache.
Well, that's all I could think of when Jeff said they got to the Castle Anthrax and... Bathroom break, gentlemen. Go take care of your business. Come back and we'll watch the rest of the movie.
And, I remember my brothers bringing that home because they used to bring home a lot of R-rated films. And by that time, I was the fourth in line with the kids. So I think my parents just gave up and said, that's fine, just watch whatever.
Go ahead. So, twist your mind.
Yeah, go ahead.
And I didn't work on the first three, Briggers.
That's right. I just remember being afraid at that age of being like six and being afraid of the two-headed guys. The two-headed?
Three-headed.
Three-headed, that's right.
Yeah.
Snore! that was the only...
You got bad breath.
Yeah, that was the one that I was afraid of, that scene. But everything else I loved, so... Blake?
I think it would go back to middle school. I was a big fan of Monty Python's Flying Circus. Back then, before cable, you can only see it on public TV. They would have an hour. They had 30
like
minutes.
Saturday night.
Yeah, it'd be like Saturday night at midnight or 1 a.m.
Yeah,
on PBS, public television.
After Saturday Night Live was over, you'd flip over to PBS.
Flip over to PBS.
You could watch. Yeah, you're right. You could.
You'd watch a half hour of Monty Python, and then it was followed by Benny Hill, and I'd always watch Benny Hill because I wanted to see boobies. And sometimes I was not disappointed. So, and that was on public television, folks.
It was.
Goofy liberals. But anyways.
Well, because boobies shouldn't be against the law.
Yes.
Here we go. The film has made nearly $130 million. Now, gross, since it came out in 75.
Now, is that at the box office?
I'm wondering if it's box office and VHS.
It's got to be.
Yeah. So,
yeah, I mean, a combination of all...
It was made for $365,000.
Well, and also for things like, you know...
The little rabbit that you brought.
Toys.
I think that actually goes to the Spam-a-lot.
And things like...
You dirty double-crossing rat!
To save money, the film was shot almost entirely in the same castle with different lighting and angles to appear to be different buildings. The producers were so strapped for cash, they decided to forego the use of actual horses and just include the characters banging coconuts together and mimic the sound.
Whoa!
You're not riding horses, you're banging.
Thank you very much.
Banging coconuts.
So, yeah, this was the first comedy that I remember. I did see Police Academy before this. So I did say comedy, so Monty Python.
they're both slapstick, but in a very different genre. You know, you either like British comedy or you hate it. Mm-hmm. Well, sorry, I should say you either love it or you hate it. There are people who watch the movie or watch any Monty Python and they're like, I don't get it. I don't get it. And that's fine. They're just in the other half.
I give props to my grandparents because they let me, when they used to babysit me, they used to let me watch Benny Hill. And that's where, like, at 4 and 5 years old, I was watching Benny Hill. And I loved Benny Hill. Still do.
Nice.
And it's
who
still...
wouldn't love Benny Hill?
The Yakety Sax.
Exactly.
Can somebody sing that?
You know, actually, we would watch Cleveland Browns game exclusively to Yakety Sax soundtrack. Turn the volume off.
He's not kidding.
I'm not kidding. Because I actually said I'd rather listen to Yakety Sax and watch the game than listen to the commentators. And it actually made the game better.
Did it?
Yes, it did.
Johnny Manziel looking good.
And actually, the Browns screwing up, turning interceptions and fumbling, it's like perfect.
What's funny is that first time we decided we were watching one of the games, it was literally so bad. They were about 25-0 or something. I mean, it was brutal. And so we're like, this is as bad as like, you should just throw some theme music in the background. And so we're like, so we muted it and we literally played it, the game. On DVR with this on. And you'd be amazed. It was like it was designed for this music. Every single play, loss of 4 yards. Fumble, recovered by the Browns. Pass, complete, but short of a first down. Punt, touchdown for the other team. Ball comes back to Cleveland. Loss of 3 yards. Incomplete pass. Quarterback throws it backwards.
Exactly. Well,
and this is what happens every time.
Can we play this during the playoffs with the Bengals and Andy Dalton?
Actually, that's a good idea. I suggest anybody who has...
We probably could have played it during the preseason game yesterday.
Doesn't count. Preseason doesn't count. Johnny Manziel looks good during preseason. It doesn't count.
I am sure a lot of Reds games could work well this week. Oh. But you got to play them in fast forward, I think.
Yes.
So,
yeah.
Baseball is very boring and takes a long time.
I don't want to see Brian Price in lingerie. Yeah.
There's a good question for Devin and those cheeky monkeys across the big pond. Was there ever any cross-pollination?
Devin's at Snake Oil. He's in Michigan.
Devin's in Michigan. 365. Kevin and Chris are over at across the pond.
Is it cross from Lake Erie?
That's the pond, Lake Erie.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
No, for Kevin Bruce and listeners and stuff. Yeah. Was there any cross-pollination between Benny Hill and Monty Python?
Oh.
Like, did they ever, like, appear on each other's shows or together in a skit? If anything meshed
together, it would be Benny Hill and...
I don't ever remember seeing Benny Hill on a Flying Circus episode, but that doesn't mean they didn't do anything together.
No, but did fans of Benny Hill... Yeah. I mean, obviously, yeah. I think there was...
Oh, I'm sure they had similar fans.
My question is, when did Rowan Atkinson start going into this?
After I stopped caring.
No, I'm just asking. I mean, was he... 80s? Was he 90s?
He was late
80s, I think.
Blackadder, he was the...
Wait, Atkinson's Mr. Bean, right?
Mr. Bean.
Yeah, okay, that's what I'm talking about.
And
okay.
Blackadder.
He was the Blackadder.
Okay. They're making more of that, too. They're coming... Yeah, they're
bringing out more Blackadder?
Yeah.
Is Rowan?
Yes.
In it?
Yes.
Get out of here.
I'm not kidding.
Like grandfather now?
I guess.
Good for him.
Mr. Bean was one I never liked.
Really? See, yeah. I
couldn't
I
get into
Mr.
that.
Bean was
I just...
funny.
His first movie was funny.
For what
oh
it was.
Oh, my God.
Bean? The second one was bad.
I didn't even know he made a second one. I was referring to the television show.
No, the television show I thought was quality, actually.
Oh, I didn't like it at all.
For what it was.
And that music is top five. We're not ending the show too early, but we want to get to the top five first because...
there might be some spurlers coming up.
Yeah, because we love Monty Python so much. The top five this week is top five moments, favorite moments from Monty Python, the Holy Grail.
I fart in your general direction.
That's probably about three or four of our...
and actually, right before, real quick here, Doug B, number one fan, did just tweet to us, best theme song in the business for Mr. Bednar for the HOBI theme song. I told you.
Number one fan, Doug, says that's the best.
I'm not kidding you. We get tweets probably about once a month or so.
Get
somebody
out of
mentions
here.
The theme song. I'm not kidding, Jeff. Do we not get comments about that?
Jeez. We do not get comments about
no,
that.
We do get comments. No, we do. A lot of people love it. So, and also we do apologize during the listener feedback. There could have been some audio issues. We apologize for that little bit, but hopefully everything's working now.
No, that's just how bad my voice is. Sorry.
So we apologize.
That's what happens when you work with no budget.
Yes.
And it's all on IOUs,
which is just as good as money. okay, so top five moments. One other quick thing here. Erica Hunter over at Pittsburgh Nerd. The podcast.
Yeah.
They were talking to us today. They wanted us to do next week, because we didn't have enough time. They just sent it over. They want us to do, if the movie could ever be remade, Monty Python and the Holy Grail, and for a draft day, she wants us to draft a new Monty Python movie. That's a tough one.
Well, that's a real tough one. Well, especially since, like, the actors played multiple characters themselves as it is.
Yeah.
Like Michael Palin played like 12 different people in that movie.
We don't even need to draft. I mean, real quick, do you think of it? Here's what my guys that I thought about. I thought Amy Schumer could probably do it because you gotta be somebody that just doesn't give a fuck. That is can insult. I thought she was
okay. So she'd be Zoot?
I don't know who she could be. I'm just giving you some like a troop that could do it. The other one is Jeffrey Ross, the Roastmaster. What do you think?
I couldn't imagine him doing Holy Grail at all.
You don't think?
No.
No, never mind then.
I don't know where you're going with that one, Jay.
I thought the attitude,
who,
maybe.
Who's that jackass British guy who gets all these roles as a comedian?
Oh, yeah. He was married to, what's her name?
Katie
that annoying Katy Perry.
Oh, Russell Brand.
Russell Brand.
Oh, God. But what I'm telling you is, this is why it's a bad idea.
He did
Russell Brand will end up going into this movie and then ruin it for the rest of us.
How about
no offense to Russell Brand fans, but he sucks.
How about James
Earl Jones?
No, not James Earl Jones. The late night talk show host, James Corbin.
He
could probably do it.
He probably could pull it off a little bit.
I'm not saying you're going to replace these guys. I get that you're not going
to. I think John Cleese, Morgan Freeman, she turned me into a newt.
But why a newt? I thought that was good, though. That was a good one. I don't know who you could go with.
Yeah, we wouldn't do a draft day on that. Maybe a Riddle Me This. But
we could do a Riddle Me This next week, maybe.
There you go. That might be a little.
We'll have to think about that for the next week.
It might be blasphemy.
I think it's going to come up blasphemy.
Top five favorite moments from Monty Python and the Holy Grail. Bednar, you're the guest. You go first with your number five.
My number five has got to be the French taunting.
Don't come here with that posh talking nasty stuck-up twit.
That wasn't one of the French ones.
That's not...
I'll wave my private pants at your aunties.
Yeah, there you
exactly.
Go.
We're looking for the grand.
All the French taunting, so it actually counts for two major scenes. So I also knock out my Blake
two
top
for,
five, two for. There's two major scenes of French taunting.
The French from the beginning and the French taunting at the end.
Exactly, and yeah, it's to me that's got to be one of the top ones. I'm sure there's a couple of you guys.
I was going to say we should do top five scenes, but then it was like that was a whole lot of overlap.
Yeah, there's a ton of overlap. Mm-hmm. So moments could be anything.
Yeah, moments
it
could be
just a quote. Yeah. Or it could be
a whole scene. Yeah,
right. So the French taunting. Both.
I considered putting the entire movie as one of my favorite favorite moments.
Jeff, what's your number five?
My number five is when they ate Robin's minstrels and there was much rejoicing.
Yay.
Yay. Like anytime we do that all and whenever we're cheering for something, it's like, and there's much rejoicing.
Yay.
I was never a big fan of the cartoons in between the scenes, but then when I got older and watched it again, I really enjoyed it.
Started to appreciate it a lot more. Yes, it's true.
My number five is such a small little thing. When they're running away from the castle, Lancelot takes his sword and he strikes the castle.
He attacks the castle with his sword.
There's actually several times in the movie where he randomly strikes things with his sword.
And he just runs up and goes, "Wah!" And then they run off.
Good moment right there. That's
my number five. That makes me laugh every time they're running away from the cow being shot. He's one last shot at it.
Lancelot actually attacks the castle.
Yes.
He might be my favorite character in that. Go ahead, Blake. What's your number five?
What is your name?
My name is Sir Lancelot of Camelot.
What is your quest?
To seek the Holy Grail.
What is your favorite color?
Blue. Go on. Off you go.
What?
Okay,
that's
thank you.
Easy.
Thank you very much. That's easy.
That's easy.
Okay, you don't need to read the whole script.
Answer me these questions three. They're the other side, EC.
Ask me the questions, Bridge Keeper. I'm not afraid.
I'm not afraid.
What is your name?
Sir Robin of Camelot.
What is your quest?
To seek the Holy Grail.
What is the capital of Assyria?
I don't know that.
The Bridge of Death.
The Bridge of Death.
We did get a couple top fives that I'll get into from listeners after this. But
I would say questions three was my number four.
Yes, the Bridge of Death was my number four.
Yeah,
so
questions.
I'll knock that one off.
El Hino had, what is the capital of Assyria? What? I don't know that. And then he also had, what is the airspeed velocity of an
unladen
swallow?
Unladen swallow.
Afternoon European.
I don't know that.
What do you mean?
No. But actually, the part of the questions three I really like was when they see them, it's like, oh, there's the guy from scene 24. And it's, and it's like, Robin, why don't you go up there? He goes, oh, I got a better idea. What's that? How about if Lancelot goes?
Sir Robin.
Sir Robin ran away
from Camelot.
So, what's your number four?
My number four, I am your king.
Well, I didn't vote for you.
You don't vote for
kings. You don't vote for kings.
Why'd you become king then?
The Lady of the Lake. Her arm clad in the purest shimmering semi-tel aloft Excalibur from the bosom of the water, signifying by divine providence that I, Arthur, was to carry Excalibur. That is why I am your king. Listen, strange woman, lying pawns, detuning swords, no basis for a system of government. Supreme executive power derives from a mandate from the masses, not from a farcical aquatic ceremony.
Well done.
Thank
well
you.
Done.
That was my number one, so Blake's two off my list now.
Do you have anything left?
As he was quoting with me.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I have that one memorized.
Yes, that's awesome. Nice.
If I was to say I was emperor because some moistened bit lobbed a scimitar at me, they'd put me away.
Because he's the such disdain they have for the king. And I love the line, I didn't vote for you. Yeah. My number four is the Black Knight scene. When he's just killing. Your arm's off. No, it isn't.
Just a flesh wound.
Go ahead.
I was reading something about that just earlier today, about John Cleese, you know, wrote that scene, came up with the inspiration. He was reading about ancient Rome, and there was a wrestling match in, like, ancient Rome where two wrestlers were going at it, you know, for a very long, very hard time. And eventually one guy tapped out, finally tired, and they found out that the other opponent had died sometime during the wrestling match. So he posthumously won a wrestling match. And that got to John Cleese thinking, it's like, well, you can never lose if you never give up. So he wrote that scene with that in mind.
Come back, y'all. Put your legs off.
There you go. Little bits of information that you didn't think you would get. There you go.
Yeah.
It's just a flesh wound.
It's the Black Knight. Yeah, that's my number one.
I took it down. Put on the board.
How many times have you been playing D&D? Like, oh, just but a flesh wound.
Oh, yeah.
Devin and Pop Culture Podcast also, they both had that scene as one of their tops. So
it is
classic. I
think classic.
That universally is one of the... that's got to be... When you ask somebody about their favorite scene, they're going to say...
The Black
it's
Knight.
A flesh wound.
Yeah. It's a flesh wound. And I'm going to say, like, first couple times you see it, you know, that scene stands out. So it's like, exactly. I think things, the more subtle ones were the ones that kind of make my list.
And the best part is when he kneels down to start praying for victory.
Kicks him in the head.
He's got no arms.
You've got no arms.
Yes, I do. They're laying right there.
Come on, you pansy.
Just a flesh wound.
Jeff, what's your number four?
My number four was the questions three at the Bridge of Death.
Okay, Bednar, what's your number four?
That was my number four. I moved to my number three, right?
Yes.
So this one actually has a better background story to it. So this one is Brave. It's Brave Concord, and you probably...
Message for you, son.
So you hear that. Now, the reason why this is...
Jesus.
The reason why this one's one of my favorites.
You can go fuck yourself.
That's number one.
That's your number one?
This was on my Outlook. I'm
message for you, Jason.
I work in IT. So
he's got your number one.
For about 5 years of my life, every time I got an email in my Outlook, that is literally how the email came in to my...
Message for you, son.
Every single time for 5 years.
I hate you. I hate you so much.
So...
Oh, come on, we already lost our number one.
Just Brave Concord standing there at the beginning of Sir Lancelot's story. As you're walking through the forest and he's ready to go.
Well, Jeff and I, when Jeff used to work at the movie theaters, we used to preview movies. And anytime there's an arrow shot or somebody was shot with a bullet, we always would go, message for you, sir.
Or anytime the movie was getting very preachy,
yes,
and like, and
yes,
we're like, oh boy, shoop, message for you, sir. Like, they're being so overhandedly preachy.
A lot of Freddie Prince movies
so
had
that's
messages.
If that's your number one, I mean, it's more, one. I mean, I highly respect that. Just let
I love
let
that scene.
Known. There's a reason why that was only made my third one, but we'll know as we come back.
What's your number three, Jeff?
It's my number three. My number three is the beginning of the tale of Lancelot. When there's...
Message for you, sir.
Well, right after the message, when they are standing...
Brave Concord, you didn't die in vain! Oh, I'm not dead, Jeff.
When he approaches the castle, when he's approaching Swamp Castle,
okay,
when he has the two guards standing
there,
and he's running in the distance, the drum's going, and then it cuts back to them standing there. And then it cuts back to him, and he's not getting any closer. It does it like four or five times. And all of a sudden, stabs one guy, and the other guy's like, hey, as he runs in.
That's my number two.
How they're wearing flowers on their little helmets.
They're celebrating a wedding.
That is my number two, you motherfucker.
So you're one and two are now dead.
I laugh more when the guard goes,
Hey.
Exactly.
Than anything else.
It's like, we see this guy approaching from the distance, and then the next thing, he's just there, and it's like, hey,
you killed the bridal party.
The original Red Wedding.
Yes. George was the original Red Wedding.
That's also when the guy's son, the groom, is trying to go out the window. He's like, hold on, time out. And he just cuts the rope, and he just falls.
I suppose that is, you know, he needed Concord to stay behind because he wanted to do it in his own idiom. I suppose running for a long, long time and then approaching suddenly.
How
is
else were
idiom.
You going to do it in your own
I just like
idiom.
I think like he stabbed the castle a couple times, too.
I just like that whole...
He did take a hanging floral arrangement on the side of the wall. And he goes,
I think he does that and candles in it. Candles. He does candles.
You kicked him behind the chest. I hope she's all right.
Okay, my number three and my last one because, well, it's all done. It's two and one. I went back and forth on this one. I am going with the rabbit scene. The tiny little rabbit. I'm Tim, the enchanter.
You're going the whole scene. You're going from Tim all the way through the rabbit.
My favorite part is when the rabbit jumps the first time. Because
it kills Sir Bors.
Yeah, he's like, just go kill it. Yeah. Just go kill it. And he goes, okay, sir. And he walks out there. And the first time you watch it, you're like, what the hell is going on? And you see the
rabbit like on a line streaking through the sky.
And he's got
the guy,
great big... Thanks! That is my number three. Bednar did bring the rabbit with the big teeth to the studio today.
Yes, there's a plush doll rabbit with big pointy teeth.
Does the mouth move?
That's exactly...
Yeah, squeezes from his butt.
Squeeze his butt. There you go. Top to bottom. There you go.
Oh, there it is.
And you can attack Blake now with it.
Oh, blood spurting.
Yeah,
I like the tongue sticking
actual
out.
Actual blood, yeah.
I like the tongue. Okay, Blake was your number three.
We were in the nick of time. You were in great peril. I don't think I was. Yes, you were. You were in terrible peril. Look, let me go back in there and face the peril. No, it's too perilous. Look, it's my duty as a knight to sample as much peril as I can. No, we've got to go find the Holy Grail. Come on. Oh, let me just have a little bit of peril. No, it's unhealthy. I bet you're gay. I'm not.
I'm not.
The end of the castle anthrax.
Was there nudity in that scene?
No.
I can never remember if there's nudity.
Not officially.
I think there were gowns loosely clad, but I don't think there was any nippleage.
Okay.
I would remember that if there were, specifically.
No, there was no official...
No, just talking about nudity. Spanking and oral sex.
And then the oral sex.
The oral sex.
Who did? Somebody had that word.
Spank me. No, spank me.
They had that quote and then it was like, and then the oral sex. And then it would echo. Sex. Somebody had that. They played that on. Oh, where the hell was that?
Oh, my goodness. That's great.
What's your number two, Blake?
My number two, of course, was the wedding scene.
The Red Wedding.
The original Red Wedding. But I could also go, and Saint Attila raised the hand grenade up on high, saying, oh Lord, bless this
sky. Now he's
reading
my number two.
The holy hand grenade?
That with it thou mayst blow thine enemies to tiny bits in thy mercy. And the Lord did grin. And the people did feast upon the lambs and sloths and carp and anchovies and orangutans and breakfast cereals.
All right, move on with it.
And the Lord spake, saying, first shalt thou take out thy holy pen, then thou shalt count to three, no more, no less. Three shall be the number thou shalt count, and the number of the counting shall be three. Four shalt not thou count, neither count thou two, except then thou counting proceed to three. Five is right out. Once the number three, being the third number, be reached, then lobbest thou holy hand grenade of Antioch towards thy foe, who being naughty in my sight shall snuff it.
It's actually my least favorite scene in the whole movie.
Oh,
I'm sorry. It really is.
Oh, no, yeah. My number two, the Book of Armaments, chapters 9 through 21. Yeah.
One, two, five, three,
sir!
I do like when they lob it, and you think this big explosion is just...
Right.
And just kills it.
It killed the beast.
It kills the rabbit.
Kill the rabbit. So that is your number two, Blake, right?
Brave Sir Robin ran away.
He bravely ran away.
I did not.
When danger reared its ugly head,
he bravely turned his tail and fled.
Brave
Sir Robin.
Yes,
brave Sir Robin turned about.
My number two was Lancelot stabbed the two guards. Out.
He only stabbed one guard. The other guard
said, hey!
My number two was the Book of Armaments.
Bednar, your number two?
Chapters 9 through 21.
Yes, my number two was the spankings at Anthrax.
Spank me.
I need more specifically the spankings.
Spank me.
They're doctors? Well, they've got some medical training. Dr. Piggy? Dr. Watson? That's the zoot.
What's your number one, Bednar?
The only reason I had Winston. To, you know. How could you not have Castle Anthrax in there? So my number one it's the entire witch trial scene.
Hey, nobody else mentioned that yet.
Now,
that was an audible mention for me.
It's been my favorite scene. I will go back and just watch that scene if I had to choose any scene of all of the Holy Grail to watch. And I think it's because it almost seems like it lends itself to a flying circus skit. You could actually separate that entire skit and pull it out of the Holy Grail, and it would stand alone on its own as a hilarious, funny skit. One of the things I love about it, actually, and I didn't catch it for years, or it just took me a long, long time, is the beginning of the scene, the very beginning, they've got the witch, they're bringing her up, and Vedemir, you cut over to him, and he's sending... He's attaching a coconut to a swallow and sending it out. I mean, that's the little things that attach itself to other scenes and other parts of the movie that it's so quick and so sudden that if you watched it once, twice, three, four times, you probably wouldn't catch it ever. Yeah. And then finally, after you've seen it, you know, 20 times, you're like, holy shit, he's putting a coconut on a swallow. And of course, you know, the rest of it is you know, who is so wise in the ways of science.
And, he's so wise. And that is how we know that the universe is banana-shaped.
Well, I mean, the whole, it's like, what else, the question of what else floats in water?
Small churches, tiny rocks.
Apples.
Apples.
Churches. Churches is the best response to that.
But she turned me into a newt.
A newt?
I got better.
Would you dress her up? No!
Well, a bit. We did the nose.
A little bit.
We did the nose.
What's also nice about that scene, Eric Idle, because it's such low budget, they had to do a number of scenes and as many few takes as possible. It's they mentioned that Eric Idle bares his teeth and bites down on the blade of the scythe that he's holding.
He bites down
It's
on
not
it.
Scripted. He's actually trying to stop from bursting out laughing. And if you watch the movie, you can see him. He starts shaking slightly because he's trying to keep his laugh under control.
Right when that happens is when he goes, when he asks, and what else floats? Or,
build a bridge out of her.
Right. No, well, what else floats on one hand? And he's about ready to lie. You see him biting it, and John Cleese goes, because she's made of
wood.
Like, there's this long silence, and you just see Idle biting down on it. You know, purposely are waiting for Cleese's line, and Cleese is doing it perfect. He's stoic.
Cushies. Made of wood?
Yes. And in that scene, he quickly turns his head to one side because he couldn't hide his laughing because he was grinning so broadly. So he had to turn his head away from the camera. And then they also say that if you look at Michael Palin during that moment in the scene, you can see he's also hiding laughter at the same time.
Well, and then all the way to the very end of that scene where they actually weigh her against the dock. And they knocked out the witch.
Oh, yes.
And she it's the same. And she turns and goes, it's a fair call.
It's a fair call.
It's a fair call.
Wait, is everybody's number one done now? Yes.
That was my number
okay,
one.
Okay, good. Okay, I'm just making sure.
This is number one. My number one was Dennis giving his...
Dennis, yes.
You could have called me Dennis. I didn't know you were called Dennis. You didn't bother to find out.
We did get a question from, I think it was El Hino or Pop Culture Fan. Who's your favorite Monty Python character or actor?
The actor?
Yeah. Not the character, the actor. I'm going with Michael Palin. I like him the best.
I think that was a Michael Leal question.
Oh, it was Michael Leal. I'm sorry.
Who's your favorite Python troop member?
Sorry.
It used to be Eric Idle, but I think as I got older, I appreciated Michael Palin's skits and his acting better.
Eric Idle went down when he did Europeanification.
It's the best vacation movie.
Stop it. Anyways. Anyone else?
I go with Cleese.
Cleese is a close second.
Yeah. I mean, he had... I mean, ultimately, he ended up having probably the most successful film career, but a lot, you know, his ability to own the scene when he was the main character, like the Sir Lancelot scene, just blows away all of the other ones solely because of his ability to just to own the camera and the scene itself. And sorry, I just get out of.
Or can I pick Neil Innes as my favorite? He's the guy that did all their music and played
the. There's nothing wrong.
Michael Palin and John Cleese were in Fish Called Wanda. Yes, another great film. Yep. Hello, Kens! Pets!
Wanda.
Asshole! You're coming to kill me! John Cleese, or, Otto asked me, why did they name his daughter after a car?
Porsche.
I don't know. I'd have to go with John Cleese. I think when I was younger, I liked Eric Idle a lot more, but as I got older, I liked John Cleese. That's naturally. If you seen a lot of the interviews with the Python troupe, they would all say that Graham Chapman is the best actor, despite acting through his alcoholism and delirium tremens.
Yeah.
You know, problems that he had.
Well, he was probably the most talented of all of them.
Right? Yes.
Well, which is very common of the ones who have the biggest trouble with, you know, controlling their own
substance
demons.
Yeah, maybe
substance
so, yeah.
Blake is the most talented of the HOBI guys, and you can barely get him through the front door because of this Bob studio. His ego is so huge. He's like, fucking roll out the red carpet, brigger!
And Graham Chapman was excellent in Yellowbeard. If you've never seen Yellowbeard.
I have seen Yellowbeard.
I've heard you talk about it.
He was in Yellowbeard.
He was Yellowbeard.
He was the main character in Yellowbeard.
Get the...
What did he die of?
Overdose?
Did he have AIDS? It was cancer, or I thought it was something cancer earlier.
Oh,
related.
Now we're going to have to look that up.
I got alcohol, it. I got you.
Alcohol related, I think. I mean, it would make sense.
Definitely alcohol helped speed along whatever he had.
Gods, make sure that Prince doesn't leave this room until I come and get him. Not to leave the room, even if you come and get him. No.
John Cleese was blind pew.
No. Until you come and get him, we're not going into the room. No. You stay in the room and make sure he doesn't leave. And you'll come get him.
Right.
He was diagnosed with...
We don't need anything apart from just stop him entering from the room. No, leaving the room.
Right. We don't leave the room unless he leaves with us.
No.
Keep him in here and make sure...
He doesn't leave.
Oh, yeah, we'll keep him in here, obviously, but if he had to leave and we were with him, just keep him in here until you or anyone else, anyone else, just me, just you. Get back. All right? Right, we'll stay here until you get back and make sure he doesn't leave.
Who?
Make sure he doesn't leave.
The prince? Yes, make sure he doesn't leave.
Yes!
Of course. I thought you meant him. It'd be funny me guarding him and being a guard and all.
Yeah. I thought he meant him. No, it's even
better. Him needing a guard and all.
Is that clear? Oh, quite clear. No problems. Right. Where are you going? We're coming with you.
No.
Make sure he doesn't leave. Oh, I see. Right. All right, so anyways, you got the news? Did we give you enough time to look it up?
I did.
Okay.
Now I'm laughing about a sad part now. Chapman was diagnosed with throat cancer.
Throat?
Yes.
After a visit to the dentist in November 1988. It spread to his spine.
Ooh.
And he died in October 1989, the day before the 20th anniversary of the first broadcast of the Flying Circus.
Moment of silence.
Moment.
Awesome.
Okay.
I think one of the last appearances he ever did was the Iron Maiden video, Can I Play With Madness?
Wow.
Really?
Truly.
Not to look
now, that
up.
There
now,
there is information Trivia. That you can only get from the HOBI podcast right there, Jeff.
Or online. You can probably look it up online.
Ah, fuck that. Listen to the podcast. I never would have even thought about looking that shit up online. Really?
Well, I didn't look it up. I remembered when the video came out.
This is why I'm saying it's better than Google.
I'm better than Google. Y'all heard
Jeff,
it.
Jeff, better than Google. That's your new nick, Jeff. Better than Google.
Chapman and Cleese have been were friends since college, so it was his writing partner.
Yeah.
So, we also got another one from Michael Leo, I think, had it. Who is your favorite character from the Holy Grail?
Dennis.
Which one's Dennis?
Dennis is pretty good.
The commune good, guy,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Yes.
Help me true out. Supreme executive power derived from the mandate from the masses, not some farcical aquatic ceremony.
He must be like king. How do you know that? He ain't got shit all over him. He ain't got shit on.
Who's the guy that does the coconuts?
Patsy?
Patsy. Yeah. Now, he's my honorable mention.
I like him.
Patsy is my honorable mention because Patsy has to... Anyone?
Whoa!
And that takes talent to get that right.
Yeah,
And anyone else?
Oh, sorry, go ahead.
No, I'm just saying for like an honorable mention, like one of the I always loved is just the line, run away!
I had that as honorable mention, yeah, like, too.
Every time something happens, I'll try the cider. Every time something happens, run away!
Run away!
I just remember...
There's no retreat. It's run away!
I remember just we'd be... at the arcade playing the gauntlet game and that was
gauntlet,
run
yeah.
away run and everyone away! Run away when we were getting an onslaught and
the Holy Grail ale is quite good. I have to admit I'm quite impressed with it.
It's not bad. I would say
I like it that it's tempered over burning witches.
Yes,
I like that. We also did get another thing. I'm not as familiar with Flying Circus as much, but we did get a thing about what?
Are we recording?
Yeah.
No, I'm just checking.
Yeah. We're recording.
Blake tuned out again.
Hi, Blake. I'm Jason.
And then Jason started talking and then him.
Hey, Blake, I know.
Tuned him out even more.
El Hino, your pod lover, asked what your favorite musical scene from Monty Python the Flying Circus was.
All right, who wants to start?
I'll start. My favorite musical number is the Philosopher's Song.
Okay.
You're looking at me.
I mean, I understand. I'm just surprised.
Oh, I love
of all the songs.
Emmanuel Kant was a real pissant who's very rarely stable. I digger was a boozy beggar who could think you under the table. David Hume could out-consume Miller, Frederick Nagel, and Liechtenstein was a beery schwein who's just a schlossen schlegel.
Yeah,
that's
very
only the first
good.
One.
Impressive. I'd have to go with the Lumberjack song.
Oh, that's a classic.
That's my
classic.
Number one.
I'm a lumberjack and I'm okay.
I'm going to have to go with Every Sperm Is Sacred.
No, that's from a movie.
Python song.
It's a Python song.
You can change it if
it's
you want.
It's on the disc, man.
Okay.
Every Sperm
you
want is
to change
sacred.
It.
That's cool.
I mean, look on
if
the bright side
the
of life.
Sperm is wasted.
God gets quite irate.
I do apologize. I don't think Erica Hunter is from Pittsburgh Nerd.
No, she is.
Yeah, you. I'm looking at that. I was like, I don't know why I thought that. So I apologize, Erica. I don't know why. So I apologize, Pittsburgh Nerd. I'm just equating people
to
you.
That's wrong. Made her from Pittsburgh and you made her a nerd. I mean, come on.
Sorry.
That's a double insult.
Erica, I'm really sorry.
But those guys from Pittsburgh Nerd are cool. I was just like, I don't remember an Erica in Pittsburgh Nerd.
I'm just out of it, so I apologize for later on. So
like
30 minutes later.
I know Sean and Ian. I'm just...
Sorry. Anyways, I agree. I think Lumberjack is quite possibly my favorite one. Just because the Mounties like, all like, look at him like, just like my papa.
Just like women's clothing. Just like their
papa.
His girlfriend starts crying.
El Hino, his one was, his number one was Look on the Bright Side.
Oh, what's he have from a movie?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Bright Side of Life.
Oh, I'm sorry. His actually is Sit on My Face. His number one is
Sit on My Face.
So tell me that you love me. I'll sit on your face and say that I love you.
Look on the Bright Side, and Every Sperm is Sacred is in his top five, he said. My bad.
Okay.
So, but yeah.
Don't ask Jason to check your facts.
No. Facts?
Facts? What are facts?
On a podcast? I don't know.
All right, we got to get a new intern. This old one's not working out.
So, we got anything else on Monty Python? Anything else anybody you want to talk about?
You stupid bird brain! Let it.
All right, that's it.
Anything else?
I think we're good.
Okay,
that's it for Monty Python. All right. Well,
here's
the 40 years
I podcast just with.
Here's to another 40 more.
40 years to the Holy Grail and to Monty Python.
Yay! And if anybody has any listeners have anniversaries or even movies, it doesn't have to be an anniversary. Movies that you want us to talk about in full, or is TV shows in full? You know, a good one.
It's gonna have to be a classic,
or it could be bad actually. Because
classic, you know, like Princess Bride. You gotta have a Princess Bride show.
We could do the Princess
Bride
one.
Nothing but Princess Bride.
Yeah, good question from your wife for that one.
Oh, my wife hates Princess Bride.
Princess Bride.
My wife hates Princess Bride.
How?
I don't know. If I knew this before we got married, there would be no marriage. Yeah,
exactly.
I don't know.
Really?
Gotta love Princess Bride.
Yeah.
This is like my wife with Steely Dan.
That's inconceivable.
I almost couldn't marry my wife because she didn't like Steely Dan, and I didn't understand it.
Is that the one guy that they only have one arm drummer?
No, he's talking about this vibrator.
I'm fucking out. I'm done.
He left a beer.
So hold on. I'm out.
Whoa.
Steely Dan's the group who named themselves after,
I know,
like,
Def Leppard. Just told you because it gets Bednar going so good. It gets Chris going so good on the music. Because I know nothing about music, and it's great. Except Bon Jovi. They're the greatest band ever. They won a Grammy for it.
Isn't Steely Dan named after, like, steampunk sexual devices?
Is it?
Steam-powered dildo, I thought. I don't know what it's Steely Dan.
You know what Foo Fighters is named after?
Steely Dan was...
Yeah, did not know that.
Steely Dan...
And I know some music... Jeff and I are going to the Foo Fighters concert this week.
All right, so I give you Foo Fighters, and that's about... That's the smallest amount of cred I can give you right now, but that's okay.
Yeah, isn't that the band that Pap Smear's in?
No, that was Nirvana. But he also
talk about one-hit wonders,
no,
Nirvana.
He is in Foo Fighters.
Oh, Nirvana Need...
He does play.
Oh, Nirvana Need, it was like a cartoon, like of a guy trying to break through the fourth wall or whatever. Oh, that was Aha.
I have no clue what Jason's talking about.
Did you just put Nirvana in Aha? Oh my god.
Take on.
Oh, the difference between Nirvana and Aha is still performing.
Oh, yeah, it's true. That is true. Yeah. And they have better music. Take on me.
Take me on.
Take on.
All I know is Nirvana never did a James Bond theme song.
That's right. Did Aha.
Touche.
Yes. Oh, okay. The Living Daylights.
I agree.
Really? Touché. Oh, that's...
Yeah, he did.
Is anyone else bothered that the James Bond theme songs are always annoying?
I like them all.
I hate them.
No, there's a couple that are pretty good. Yeah, what are you talking about?
Diamonds are for...
The Guns N' Roses one?
No.
Roses didn't do one?
No, you're talking Paul Durant McCartney. Durant did. You're talking
Guns
about...
Guns N' Roses did one, right?
No, Guns N' Roses did the...
Jesus fucking...
I'm going to hit you.
Terminator 2, they did that song.
Oh, I got that mixed up with Bond. Blake's going to kill me. Just tune me out, Blake.
That's only if Chris doesn't beat you out.
The hatred.
Also, Duran Duran did that Dance Into the Fire. That was a good one.
The View to a Kill.
Yeah, View to a Kill.
Yeah. We could do a Clue episode.
Jack White did that one a couple years ago.
Prefer Jack
Black. Chris Cornell did one.
Prefer Jack Black. Adele did one.
Adele did one.
Adele's not bad.
She did the most recent one.
Yeah, she didn't do a bad one. Is anyone excited about the new Bond movie?
The Madonna one sucked.
I am too.
Hell yeah, I'm excited about the new Bond.
The Madonna song sucked.
Yeah.
Madonna sucks, yeah.
What the...
Mike? I don't know who that is.
That's the Guns N' Roses song from Terminator 2.
Oh, see, we just got him. Oh, now I'm going to get the rabbit with big pointy teeth.
All I know is, I know you're a musician, but obviously I have the music cred. Take on me.
Yes.
How about Was Not Was? They were a great band. Everybody get on the floor. Everybody walk the dinosaur. Boom, boom, shakalaka. Boom, boom, shakalaka.
You know, there was music made after 1987.
No. Yeah, Bon Jovi came out with a couple good ones. The Young Guns 2 theme. Yeah, that was good. Young Guns.
Yeah. No, that was actually just John Bon Jovi. He didn't
have... That's true.
Richard Sambora with him at the time. So actually...
It was good.
It was not Bon Jovi, and it was pretty good.
Yeah. You know what? John Bon Jovi.
You know what? It's my life.
It's now or never.
I ain't gonna live forever.
I'll tell you what, nothing kills my rock band.
At this point,
band.
I would like to officially retract any music that I have donated to the
goddamn Bon Jovi song.
History of Bad Ideas podcast and remove my name from all official...
As long as you didn't write the stuff he was singing.
No, unfortunately, others get to deal with that.
So anyways, anything else on my Python? Are we good?
Some people just like to watch the world burn.
You motherfucker.
And it was better than you.
You motherfucker. You motherfucker.
I've been wanting to do that for a year and a half. That's for ripping on Steely Dan.
Again, the guy has one arm. That's pretty skilled as a drummer. That is skilled.
And he's named after a silver vibrator.
Steam power.
Steam power.
Steam power? Do they put coal in it?
Probably. However you get steam. Probably water. I don't know. Okay. You guys think I'm making this up?
No, but I just like antagonizing. Okay, well, Bednar, thanks for showing up.
Yes.
Do you have a upcoming event for your band?
No, I don't, actually.
Way to rub salt into that wound, Jason.
Still looking for a drummer?
We're still looking for a drummer.
There's a one-armed guy from Steely Dan.
There's a one-armed drummer, apparently, from Steely Dan, who obviously is available and likes to play with a steam dildo. Is that right?
Steel.
Steel, not
That's
a steam.
Why he's Steely Dan.
Not a steam dildo. It's a steel dildo. It's on his resume. So drummer for Steely Dan.
One
steel
arm.
Dildo. One arm.
I just picture somebody throwing like the old trains, like throwing the coal into the fire. The dildo. He's dildo going straight at it.
One arm.
Ah!
You know what? I think we would interview that guy.
I would. Yeah.
I would. So
it's kind of like, why do you pick on the Amish? Because they never know.
Any one-armed drummers out there who enjoy steel dildos, we'll take your resume.
Okay.
Send it to brewerstongue@gmail.com.
Did you ever get my request that I could join you guys as backup? I was thinking I could sing.
No, we never saw that.
Okay. Because I can do it, if you would like to.
I thought you saw it. Didn't you say throw that straight into the garbage?
Went to my spam.
Oh.
Spam. Okay, bad idea. Anybody have one? I forgot to get one this week. Anybody have a bad idea?
What about hidden gems?
Oh, you want to do a hidden gem? Okay,
hidden gems?
Yeah. Sorry, I didn't know what you had.
Yeah, we got gems that are hidden.
Gems, yeah, gems.
I've got buy and sell, too. I've got upcoming.
They're hidden where you put that Steely Dan.
Oh. What would you like as a hidden gem?
I watched episode 1 of Wayward Pines.
And?
I like it.
It gets better.
I like it because it's the untrustworthy narrator. The
I do like stories with untrustworthy narrators.
With the, yes.
And you also said that you watched Fear the Walking Dead.
Yes, I did.
How'd you like it?
I actually liked it.
I was pleasantly surprised because I went in with zero my expectation was low. Okay. My expectation was low, and it started off as bad as I thought it was going to be, but then it got better.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
I heard just the opposite. I was talking to somebody who said, I went in with high expectations because I really liked the first show, and he thought it was terrible. He's not even sure if he wanted to even give it a second episode.
Is that the same guy that hated True Detective second season 2?
Everybody.
Well, but here's the difference between the two. I went in expecting it to be horrible.
Oh, yeah. It's the expectation.
I expected it to be bad because this did not follow the comic books at all. This was an offshoot, although Robert Kirkman's the main writer on it. So that was the only reason I gave it a chance, is because I actually trust Kirkman's writing, that it could actually work. And although the opening scene was bad acting, it's pretty much all bad early on. You can see where they're going with the family, and he chose a very good dysfunctional family to work with. So I'm actually intrigued. I will watch the next one, and we'll go from there.
And they're like normal people. A counselor, school teacher. They're not like a cop.
Architect.
Fireman.
You're saying cops and firemen aren't normal people?
No, but... just like for like a normal survival.
They're heroes.
No, for a survival scenario.
You could be a hero. Oh, my God. I just pulled out Jason out of nowhere.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. This is getting bad.
How you doing?
How you doing?
So they're normal people. They're not like military men. They're not cops. They're not sheriffs. They're not firefighters. They're not whatever.
You got a
they're just normal people.
You got a druggie. You've got a dad who's on his second, not official marriage,
second family guidance counselor.
So I'll be interested in seeing where it goes from here. But I'm still not holding out a ton of hope. Anybody who went into it with a lot of high expectations probably were disappointed.
I'm going to watch it this week.
I just thought of that, though. They got a guidance counselor as one of the...
Yeah.
I mean, like, their lives and careers were worthless to begin with. How bad do they feel? How bad do they feel now that, like, the zombie apocalypse?
I had two guidance counselors in my family. I had no idea their life.
Jeff's opinions do not reflect that of the HOBI podcast.
Please send your comments to Jeff at Graphic Novice.
Come on, I'm hearkening back to Clark's, the Kevin Smith thing about the guy spitting the eggs or whatnot.
Yeah, so like, I was trying to find the bad
egg.
Oh,
it's guidance counselor syndrome. Right. Well, if your job was as meaningless as theirs, you would too. Yeah.
Well, I'm six episodes into, or seven episodes into The Newsroom, Aaron Sorkin.
Yeah.
Have you seen it, Bednar?
I watched the first one.
Okay, it gets better.
Notice I didn't say I watched the second, third, fourth, and fifth.
I don't blame you, because it is a little preachy in that. And I like Sorkin because I love Sports Night. But I've been saying it every week that I keep giving it chances.
And some people have said it's very good. And
it gets better. I just saw the one where they killed Osama bin Laden.
They killed him in there?
Came across the news. And it was a little preachy for me. It was a little too much on the nose. With that being said, up until the very last 5 minutes, it was a very good episode. And the episodes have been getting better. And he does do a decent job of picking on both the left and the right. And I like Jeff Bridges so much. I think that's the reason. I like the characters. It's not even the subject. It's the characters. And he does a good job with that. I don't think it's that great, but it is enjoyable for what it is. I mean, you can't think much about it, because you go into a Sorkin show and you know what his political views are. So whether you approve them or not, you still have them as a big part of it. So if you can get past that, it's a good show with the characters. So that's my little tidbit.
I might actually, on your recommendation, I'll go to two and we'll see if I can make it past two.
Have you watched Sports Night?
Yeah, I remember Sports Night.
Oh, you better watch your tongue.
I made it through the whole the whole season of Sports Night.
You gotta watch the whole series.
Sports Night's much better once they get rid of the laugh track.
Oh, the laugh track.
Oh, really? Is that what it was? Okay, because I watched the whole first season, I think, and I was just... I never got, you know, into it, but it was also not a horrible show either. It's like...
The second season picks up.
It was such an in-between that it just wasn't worth my time, and that was the point.
The second season picks up a lot.
Okay. Well, I might go back and watch some of
it. I would do that above Newsroom. So.
Actually, I've been meaning to ask...
Studio 60 on Sunset Strip for talking Sorkin.
I've been meaning to ask Hobi for a couple weeks now about a show called Mr. Robot. Have you...
I have not.
Nope.
I've heard nothing but good things. I've heard nothing but good things.
I've never even heard any reviews of it.
It's been pretty damn good so far. And I only went off of a recommendation from the owner of our company, who says, you know, this is a really cool show. And of course, you know, we work in IT, so this is he's an IT guy. And there are some bad scenes. I'm not going to take
there's
it.
There's some bad
where they try to make it drama and you're doing IT hero work. Trust me, bad. I understand that. But if you get past that a little bit and take the show for what it is, it's actually fantastic. It's kind of a mix between a couple different genres of, you know, the same thing. So if you may not initially like it, but if you're thinking about it, you get a chance to watch it, it's better than probably 90% of the shit out there. So
I still have Halt and Catch Fire, 9 episodes left of the second season. I watched the first one. I've watched the first season. Watched the first episode of the second season. It's not bad, but it's just one of those that I can't get right into. Like, I like it, but like if it's on DVR, I'm like, I don't feel like watching that tonight.
Right.
So
I got to ask Chris, being an IT guy, what was your opinion of the IT Crowd?
Loved it.
Really?
Absolutely loved it.
I
all the time we quote how turn it off and on. You tried turning it off and on.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, maybe it's because it was badly acted. I mean, I saw
the first... Oh, it's horribly acted.
Yeah, I mean, it's terrible.
It's horribly acted. Nobody won any Emmys or Grammys for Monty Python's work either.
No, but they're at least good acted.
No, good acted?
Good acted.
They're gooded.
They're redacted acted.
I would say that the acting is maybe... Let's give the acting in Monty Python about a C+, and IT Crowd be a C-.
Oh, I'd go closer.
It's bad acting, period. the way you look at it.
I mean,
but I think some of it, you also have to, you have to understand some of the, you know, some of the jokes that go with it. So if you,
I don't work in IT, but I think I understood the turn it off and on joke.
Like,
and
for example, my wife thought it was a hilarious show. She likes British comedy though, so it makes a difference. If you like British comedy, you'll actually, I think, appreciate IT Crowd.
I tried to watch it. I got about 3 or 4 episodes.
All those actors went on to bigger.
That's what I heard. I hear people raving about it, and I'm like,
it was better than the original Office, in my opinion. It was significantly better than the original Office.
I was not a big fan of the original Office, to be honest with you.
I didn't think it was good. I actually liked the American version of The Office much better.
I agree with that.
I thought the original version of Office was overrated. It wasn't horrible. Yeah. It wasn't horrible, but it wasn't anything that was...
I loved the IT Crowd. I thought it was hilarious. And the other thing about Mr. Robot, did you like Fight Club at all?
Nah.
No?
Nah.
Yeah.
Overrated.
Really?
Yeah.
God, you guys are killing me. You'll like Mr. Robot. You won't.
Oh, okay.
Jeff, Jason,
do they fight?
Like it. Blake will.
Do they fight?
No, it's no fight, but it's split personality. You can tell that the main character is doing certain things as this person.
Okay.
Even though it hasn't been revealed yet in the show.
Oh, it hasn't?
No.
But you know
but
it
you
is.
You can tell.
I mean, because you've seen
Fight Club. Well, I mean, it's pretty obvious that it's there. He deals with mental issues, so...
I think my biggest problem with Fight Club is, like, everybody raved about how great it was before I saw it. Then I saw it, and I was like, it's okay?
That's how I kind of feel about it, too.
I mean, it was just, I suppose, hyped up so much that it couldn't meet
the hype. I rate a lot of my movies on how quotable are they afterwards, when you've seen them a couple times. And Fight Club is right up there with one of the more quotable movies. It's not an amazing movie beginning to end, but it's quotable. I still use Marla Singer as the type of issue that you would have when you've got something that annoys you to no end. And the quote from the movie was, Marla Singer, she's like the blister on the roof of your mouth that you would just go away if you could just stop tonguing it.
That's a good line.
So we'll constantly be saying, like, man, she's like a Marla Singer. And that's all you need to know. And it's like an inside joke between my wife and I. Like, now I know exactly what you're talking about.
Is that why you guys say that to me at softball? Huh?
Yes.
Only.
Come on, Marla.
And here I always thought you were just quoting League of Their Own, calling them Marla Hooch.
You were the friend that could go away if I could just stop tonguing you.
What? Bad idea of the week, number 812, tonguing your friends when they don't want it. Okay, are we all done? I think we're good.
Here's to the Marla Singers of the world.
There you go. Thanks for listening, guys. We'll be back next week, and I guess Roger says goodbye.
Goodbye.
From Walking Dead to Talking Heads, from comic books to TV sets, there's a history of not so bad, there's the history. It's the history of bad,
so bad.
The history of bad,
it's bad.
The
You are now leading the world of Musings of a Geek Podcast Network. Stay geeky, my friends.